Yeah, you're not ready to listen something, right? Yeah, it's end of last day of conference is getting a little bit tired, and I'm also tired from the jet lag, even though I'm coming from the Korea, which shares a time zone with the Japan, but I'm feeling really tired. I don't know why. Anyway, my presentation's title will be Scalable VM in Container Networking using 32-bit subnet and BGP routing. And during the session, I will try to talk and share our considerations over our network model and how we approach it and things like that. I will share it with you guys. Yeah, I'm Andrew Yongjun Kong. Yeah, my name is Kong Yongjun. And actually, our company using the English name for the preventing the, the companies, the bureaucracy is something which is really familiar in Korea. Yeah, so in my company, I am Andrew. Yeah. Yeah, Daum Kakao is the result of two major messenger company and portal company like 2 years ago. So we have a lot of services and we have a lot of people and we have a lot of resources too. And we had a lot of bunch of service too. But the thing is that we try to close, which is not profitable these days. Anyway, before merger, I was in a Kakao Talk, not Daum. Before the merger, we're having really peaceful operation like this. So when the resources kind of, we have to, when the situation comes, we have to add more resources like this. So, we are using configuration malware DB and the API, and we're using the toolbox, which is our in-house operation code to provision bare metal. Yeah. So get the new servers and provision it. And for the virtualized infrastructures like VM, and this day we try to use containers too. And the network team set up the switches and routers and VLANs too. And then, our team and our department set up the OpenStack over it using the Chef and Chef and Chef recipes. Yeah. But the thing is that this is how we grow and accelerating things like this. After the two conference mergers, I thought it was this. Yeah, the acceleration, the VM creation speed is really accelerating like this. Yeah, sometimes we had a more than 4,000 or 3,000 VMs created in a month. Yeah, but and then delete some other later time. But the thing is that we have to cover those requirements for the developers. This is just for fun, and our internal report we made some calculation based on the Amazon's price table with our computer resources. Yeah, this kind of $150,000 per month. But the thing is that this is from just one region. We have actually four active regions. So maybe we spend more than $1 million per month if we're using Amazon. Yeah, but the thing is that after a lot of resources getting created, but the thing is that we have to provide more bare metal servers and more switches and more configuration work for our virtual resource environment. Yeah, this is the thing. Like, we have to have some data center in our nation, and we have to have another data center in a global spaces. So system team and network team's job is getting red because a lot of work to do. But the thing is that after this configuration is there, our team's work kind of really easy because we automate everything. So when the servers come and when the network is just set, we're just using the Chef code and other automation stuff. Our job is kind of really small, not that small, but it's kind of easy to us. Yeah, lesson learned. The thing is that, growth doesn't come alone. Like, the infra levels of growth, it comes with scale-up situation and scale-out situation as well. Yeah, scale up includes like this. If you have this space in a rack, you have to add a, you add some servers on that. Yeah, like add the server, storage, and switches, and more power facility to supply the juice. This is not that difficult, right? So because we had a CMDB API and the database, so providing some servers over the rack is kind of easy. But the thing is the scale out situation, like add more new data center and more new availability zones through the world. Yeah, things like that. Yeah, this is kind of nightmare because we have really short time frame to prepare some data centers over the world. Yeah, this list radical changes over everything, like how we're preparing and how we're provisioning the servers and the networks and the our resource environment. And the thing is, monitoring system, logging system, and developing way of culture have to change it. Yeah, the about OpenStack, yeah. Resources for the OpenStack finally come to exist anyway, in some time later. Yeah. CPU, memory, storage, also having a shortage, like every, if my memory is correct, every 2 months, we had lacking of something. Yeah, and the thing is that they have skewness. Like from this rack, we need some storage, and from the other rack, we need some the IP ranges or the storages. Yeah, if these things happen, we can solve this situation like migration in the VM to the intended zone. Yeah, and we learned that IP is also really, really restricted and limited resources. And number of IP is also limited, right? We usually using dedicated subnet and dedicated some IP ranges in some other racks. Yeah. And the thing is that location of IP is also very restricted because the IP have to talk with the gateway, right? So when the gateway disappeared or the VM cannot talk with the VMs, it cannot talk with the other or the outside world. So managing IP resources or managing IP as a resource is really hard work to us. Yeah. Before we go further, we have I show you guys some numbers in our OpenStack cloud. Sorry. Yeah, we had 1,000 hypervisors, and we had more than 15,000 VMs on it. And for the compilation code and OpenStack code, we made more than 600 full requests from the 2014. And every day we had more than 130 VMs are created and deleted per day without any notice. Yeah, just in our cloud, just our developer or user can create VM or delete VM without our permission. And yeah, we're using Grizzly version of OpenStack, and at that time, we don't use a really good hardware for that. Actually, our boss doesn't trust us, so you don't buy a new hardware to that, just using the warranted out hardware. Like, yeah, it's a hypervisor, but it has a memory like 8 gigs or 16 gigs, and the data disk was SATA, yeah. Yeah, that was Grizzly time. But after we had some success in OpenStack Cloud, we have to buy some servers to our cluster or cloud. And now we are using Liberty version of OpenStack, which is one step behind the major OpenStack. And the thing is that we are upgraded from the Grizzly. Most of other companies are using just dedicated server and specified version. If you want to or add more server, you have to have the new version of OpenStack, which is not compatible with the other cluster or other several per beer. Yeah, using the same version of OpenStack through the cluster. And we had four regions. Some regions in the south side, some regions in the north side, not North Korea. Yeah. And besides just providing VM, we are using HID, which is the VM orchestrator, and the Trove, which is the database service, and Sahad. Oh, by the way, do you have any knowledge over the OpenStack? Okay, then I then I talk you. Explain to you. Sahara is a big data ecosystem, like based on the HID, you can make a bunch of cluster or a bunch of VM for it to install Hadoop or to run the memory disk over it. Yeah. And we are trying to use Octavia, which is the load balancing system for the OpenStack. And now I'm involving with this project too. Before we move to the 32-bit routing or full mask routing service, we are using the VLAN-based provisioning network, which is network team or network guy set up the VLANs and IP ranges for us, and we are using that as an ML2 plugin, which is an abstraction layer for the level 2. Network level 2. And the thing is that we're not using OVS, and we're using Linux Bridge. When I talk this to some OVS guys, they're asking, why? Do you have some bug, or do you have some performance degradation from the OVS? No. Yeah. It's not because of OVS is bad or not stable. It's because the Neutron, Neutron itself, by default, Neutron using OVS. But the thing is that, actually last year, it has some issue with the restart, managing the OVS plugin daemons. Like when we're upgrading or when we patch something to the OpenStack, we have to, or sometimes we have to restart the OVS manager managing daemons, right? But the thing is that when it restarts, it gets new flow from it deletes all the flow in the OVS and gets new flow from the Neutron API servers. During that time, maybe two or three pings lost during that progress. Yeah, which is kind of okay, right? But the thing is that our database team has some HA solution over our virtual infrastructures. But the thing is, if they lose one or two ping count, they're trying to HA. Yeah, so that's gonna problem. So we, move to the Linux Bridge, which is just using the static VLAN ID over the Linux Bridge. But the thing is that after we complete or done with moving from the OVS to Linux Bridge, OpenStack, made a patch for that. Even though agent restart, it doesn't delete every flow. Yeah. So nowadays we are trying to move to back OVS. which is kind of hard. And network team, plan for our environment. VLAN and gateway and IP, things like that. And we mapping the availability zones from the OpenStack to the VLAN, like this. So one VLAN have a one zone, which is almost one rack. So one rack is one availability zone and one interface, one VLAN. So it was kind of good. But the thing is that after we are learning multiple availability zone, there's some imbalance between zones. Like this zone through the graph, this zone has one CPU and one storage, but the thing is that it don't have any IP, right? And this zone has nothing, but it only had IP. In this situation, we can move or delete some VMs from here and move some VM from from here to there. But the thing is, when the VM is migrated, the thing is that we have to change, or the VM have to change their subnet and the gateway too, right? Is it okay to you? Because we are the network guy, right? But the thing is that developer doesn't like that. Even though they abstract it to the DNS, they don't like the changes of IP anyway. But they don't care about the, even the VM is gone, but they really care the IP changes. Yeah. Yeah, OpenSet schedulers watching the resources through the drone and through the rack or through the compute node. Yeah. But it doesn't look the IP as a resources. Just it looking the CPU and the memories. Yeah, so we made a network count filter. Like we treat the IP as a resource for the scheduler. Yeah, select the select the zone which has more IP. Sorry. Yeah, like this. So we had some lookup tables for the IPs, which zone have a really good IP or which zone has a really lacking of IP. Yeah, things like that. We have watching. Yeah, but we experienced a hard issue. Like after we checking that, we have to have any more subnet in a certain zone, like in a certain VLAN, which is one VLAN has more than two subnets. It is kind of okay, right? But the thing is that, yeah, the network team's policy, from the network team's policy, they have to have a one subnet in a one VLAN. We are violating their rule. Yeah, that's the problem. Because, you know, we are not taking care of network itself at that time. Yeah. Yeah, you can migrate VM, as I told you, but with the IP unchanged, it's not possible with this typical setup. Yeah, so we're thinking about the connectivity too. Yeah. Yeah, it's a kind of classic here, right? So in a same subnet, you can have the MAC address from the other server, so you can using the L2 layers connection. But if the destination host is not in your subnet, you have to ask the router, and the router send the forwarding packet to another broadcast zone. And OpenStack itself using overlay to connect the different same tenant on the different host or different rack like this. So in the end of it, there's some tunnel daemon, and it forwards through the routers or internet or something, and the other pass, take the packet from the this side. So in a VM or the application inside of the VM, thinking they are in the same subnet. Yeah, it's logically true, but geographically it's separated, right? So if we're checking with the latency or something like that, it's gonna be a problem. Yeah, so we made a requirement before we changing our network model. Like IP can move through the rack and through the zone, sometimes through the DC, but we don't do that these days, you know. And we have to solve the IP resource imbalance like I explained before. Yeah, and fault resilience, like one server's gone or if the one switch is gone, we have to have a way to connect the VMs through the, even though there's some failure. And dynamically check the status of the network, which is down or which is up, and things like that. We have to automatically check. And this is just for this one. Yeah, simple IP resource management. Like we never thinking about which subnet have to go to the some VLAN or something, or where can I put my servers to under the some top of rack switches, things like that. We don't want to do that because every 1 month, network team have to solve this complicated problem and update the VLANs through the like more than 1,000 switches. But the thing is that at that time, network team doesn't using the ORMS script to update the brilliant trunking. So every time they, I understand that. Yeah, every time network team doing some job, yeah, we have some problem. Yeah, like, yeah, the brilliant trunking just gone, something like that. So we first recommended some SDN solutions to the network team, but they don't using it because they it's very hard to understand the whole the bunch of ecosystem and the whole the servers and the agent and the protocol between the SDN. They don't like it. So we Laravel, we think Laravel is the best candidate for our network requirement. Like, it dynamically detect the exchanges through the dynamic routing protocol, and it's highly distributed and highly available, right? Like just internet does. And the issue is that most of the time the routing itself done in some ranges, like some subnet or some because of, at that time we still the network guys still believe save your memory, save your CPUs for the switches. You will save your money. But the thing is that these days, Laravel has a bunch of memories and CPU capacity to calculating the bunch of routing tables. So, yeah, we finally come to end with the 32-bit subnet, like full mask IP in IPv4. Yeah. Because it uses 32-bit network, it don't have any L2 L2 environment, and we don't have to think about MAC and something like that, something like related with the L2 layers. Yeah, and the, with the dynamic protocol, it can move everywhere, right? And it make us making simple IP planning over the our whole cloud. So. This project was started from like 1.5 years ago. After that, we never asking the network guys or the network team provision or provide some subnet to us. Yeah. And the thing is it's very automated resources. So yeah, we can keep the VM's IP through the migration even though the RAG or even the DC. Yeah, how it work? Most of the time, we don't have any really many people inside our team. Even though we're running more than 15,000 VM, we have only 4 people inside our team, including me. Yeah, that's really small, right? So we're trying to utilize every open source or OpenStack stuff. So first, install the Nova network and neutral agent inside of the compute node, which just means just install the OpenStack and create some neutral networks, and it will create a DHCP server inside of compute node, which is IP, which have a specific IP through the compute node, and we try to use the same this DHCP server's IP because it's working as a gateway from the VM. So in other compute node, it had some specific same gateway IP, even because we're trying to use that as a working when we move the VMs from here and VMs from other side. Yeah, actually it's using the best pair. And when you're trying to create a VM, this Nova Compute create a VM through the libbird library, and it asks IP through the controllers, and the controller assign IP using the Linux bridge and the DHCP agent. Neutral Linux bridge agent made a bridge for the VM if the bridge is not available, and the DHCP agent get the IP from the controller and make this type of IP to the VMs like this. So yeah, this yeah, just look at the, if you look at the IP, okay, it has 32-bit routing, and the inside of the VM is using the yeah, this gateway IP as a default gateway. So packet can come from the VM and go through the other side of somewhere. And to pull the packet out of the compute node, we installed some switch router, which is Quagga. Yeah. And it told that the outside of network, that if you want to go to this VM, and we made some kernel routing to host routing to the kernel, from the kernel side, and it like this. And this information were is going up to the going advertised through the dynamic protocol, dynamic routing protocol through the some kind of protocol and to the type of rack switches, and type of rack switches now knows where the packet can go to the this IP. Yeah, first one, page one was just using RIP through the compute node and the type of rack switches and OSPF from the type of rack switches and the aggregation switches. The reason we pick RIP between the compute node and network node is it saves the CPU calculation. And the thing is that we are using default gateway as inside of compute node, so packet can go with information through the default gateway of the compute node, and it goes through that. And the packet from the outside can hopping from the aggregation switches and top of rack switches. But the thing is that when you're trying to upgrade or management the compute node itself, you have to using this default gateway. Yeah, this is going to be a problem to us because anyway, we have some mixing networks in this device management and VM service network inside of this interfaces. So we try to block this VM's packet or VM's network from the management or compute node networking. So we are using switch namespace over the DHCP servers and those switch routers, software routers. So after we define that, we're trying to using the IBGP over the top of rack switches and compute node. So yeah, the reason is that network team also want to using the BGP because they really have a bunch of knowledge over the BGP. Yeah. And after we adopting this model, we can plug and we can separate the VM's traffic and the management traffic using the software namespaces. Page three, yeah. After that, we thinking about the cost. We always thinking about cost too. So, yeah, we are using one interface. Oh no, where is it? One interface through the compute node and divided through the VLAN. So one VLAN is inside the switch namespace, and one VLAN is the management actually default namespace, and using the same interface anyway. Yeah. This is our production model hypervisor. When we show this type of configuration to the crowd or to the public, they're asking, where is the public working architecture for the compute node? We'll explain it. This is public to us. So they're asking, like, what if this interface gone? Or what if this hardware drives gone. Actually, we don't have any RAID over our compute node. We don't have any bonding through the interface. We don't have any something for the HA. So they're asking,
I was wondering if you've looked into Calico at all?
Yeah,
architecture is very
similar. Yeah, right. Because we are working together. Not working together. Actually, I met Calico like years ago. Actually, they're using, at that time, they're not using the host routing or something. They're using the proxy, right? AIP proxy. But after our discussion and our talk, they changed it using the host routing because my advice, no. Because of their thinking, yeah. It's very close to the Calico, right.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure, because, yeah, it's sounding really similar. It's like, hopefully we're not getting that from, so.
So for the HA of the VM, actually, we don't have any hardware devices for the VM, but we have some schedulers for the VM's implementation. Like, if you want some HA-based VM or service like LB or something like that, like MySQL cluster, we have some scheduler. Like, if you have a VM, this node and the other, or the slave node will be the other racks. Yeah, we can do that in the scheduler level. So when the host switches down from some rack, you can just steal the other rack's VMs. So yeah, we can use this architecture for our production service. Yeah, what is served is that the first thing we serve is the VM migration. Actually, we don't migrate VM, but and we don't say that to cluster or talk to customer like you can use or you can migrate VM. But this is just for our management work. Like, we have to upgrading some computer, right? At that time, we're trying to move or migrate VM to other log like this. If a VM is here, the information of this IP is getting through the dynamic routing protocol like this. See, if you want to go this IP, go to this type of rack, and if the VM is gone, we delete the host routing from the switch namespaces to the neutron server, neutron agent, and we rewrite host routing here, and the routing information again updated to the dynamic routing protocol. Yeah. So even if the TOR switches changes, but the thing is that IP is not, there were changes. So developer can happy with that. Yeah, so we made a simple IP planning, like just give a bunch of subnet, like 16 or just 8-bit subnet to us. We can manage we can working as a IPAM using the neutron. And resource imbalances, we can handle it because we can migrate the VM even though the IP is not changed. And also, resilience is things done in a hardware levels like TOR switches or aggregation switches. Actually, we don't care about the port anyway. And this is distributed. The thing is that because we are using the pure routing protocol and pure routing, we don't have any bottleneck in a software level or in a virtual resources level. So, yeah. We can change it, or we can use the VM in a very large number. Yeah, this is IPERF, just simple IPERF test through the VM to VM. When you see the throughput through the VM, it's a kind of old test. I tried to find the update result from these days, but yeah, it was not successful. Anyway, it was S3 level communication through the VM. With the different rack, it can have more than 7.5 gig BPS. And these days, it's more than 8 or 9 gigabit these days, even though we are using S3 network. And this is accumulation in one hypervisor to the other hypervisor, like those. So just maybe we have tested with 10 VMs, but one is gone. Maybe this VM is one server, and this VM is the other server or the other rack. But throughput can show more than 10 gig. And more than 10 gig is kind of cache effect because we can do the very simultaneously. And the thing we checked was that the memory usage is, even though we had a more than more than 20 VMs in some hypervisors, the memory is quite low. After reinventing or using this, we're trying to replicate this data model to other, like 30-bit routing with the DNAP. We can using the you can make a one-to-one NAT in a cloud level. We call it floating IP. So it's working. And this part is really interesting. We are using routing, so we can using ECMP over our IP resources or VM. So ECMP plus antenna, we can use the scalable load balance like this. So if we install the VM, if we install the HA proxy in a VM and it's working as a HA load balance, when you're trying to scale out those, we add same IP address through the DNAP in these hypervisors, and this is going through like this. So you can have a multiple same IP instance through the cluster or cloud. So we can handle the scale out story of load balance itself. And multiple routing entry multiple routing entry through the switch namespaces. So we can handle the container inside of VM like this. So you can have some subnet through the, actually it's not a subnet, but we have a bunch of fixed IP like 64 or 32 bit IP to the inside of it, and if you're using bridge network to the container, some sort of ranges, so you can use the container as a just loud, just like as you are treating as a VM, which means you can ping to the container through the user, cloud. So, the thing is that we can use the router IP to the container. So you can use the legacy IP-based monitoring to the container too. So you don't have to change your monitoring system, or you don't have to change your managing something against the container, which is really great, I think. So, and we don't use overlays. So network administrator or the server administrator doesn't care about overlay anymore. So it's kind of simple management over our virtualized cloud or virtualized infrastructures. Yeah, that's all what I have today. So do you have any questions?
IPv6.
Yeah, we try to use IPv6 in the same time. But the thing is that when you're trying to advocate or advertise the IPv4 through the IPv6 through the IPv4 gateway, it's not possible. So we're trying to make a solution for that. But we now don't care about IPv6.
One more question, because we are running out of
time. Yeah, right. I'm sorry.
I was not sure to understand your solution from containers in VMs. Do you use one virtios per containers? Hmm? How do you get many containers in the VM?
Like this, you can define some subnet to this VM, like the information, from this VM, you're like from 3 or 33 routing can come out, and we made some link bridge inside of the VM and put the virtual link to the inside of the link bridge. And before we start in the Docker, you can specify in the subnet through the configuration files. So like in this bridge, you can have this subnet. Then, yeah, when container comes up with this IP, you can through the you can using the AIP to this, and actually there's some best link through the this lens bridge and the gateway, so the packet coming through the this. Yeah, this is how working.
And did you check the options to have one virtual per container, for instance? Which means that on the host or from QEMU, you have one tab device per container.
I can follow you.
Assuming you have one tab, let's say if you have 10 containers in the VM,
yeah.
Instead of having one bridge with,
you
have 10 virtuals or 10 tab devices. So from Quagga, you just need to announce the
Yeah, right. Yeah, we have a now the information for the container inside of this Quagga.
I'm sorry.
Maybe we can talk later. I'm sorry.